Lord, say, set his name here on us, in this place. That's why we've been able to adore. Lord has chosen this very place for us. When I shut up heaven and there is no rain, or command the locusts to devour the land, or send pestilence among my people, if my people who are called by my name shall humble themselves and pray and seek my face and turn from their wicked ways, then I will hear from heaven and forgive their sins and heal their land. Did you notice where the problems come from? If I shut up heaven, if there's no rain, or no answer to prayer, there's no rain or command the locusts to devour the land, devour all your hard work, or send pestilence among my people. My people should just sit down and give up, right? We're defeated. Not what he said. But did you notice the source? They might say, why would he shut up heaven? Why would there be no rain? Why would locusts come and devour? And why would he send pestilence among the people? Because the people weren't coming into his presence as he desired. Because the people weren't trusting him as he desired. People weren't spending time with him as he desired. So if you're going through these kinds of problems in your life, I won't mention any names. I am in Sunday school. But if you're going through these problems in your life, and we all do, it seems like the locusts is devouring all that you do, and there's pestilence and problems and so forth. You've got to humble yourself and pray and seek his face and turn from your wicked ways. And we can have him forgive our sins and heal us. Heal our land, us, so forth. The title of the message today, I was thinking about preaching nothing but a bag of dirt. That would go over some good. You know, I'm really tired of preaching all these clean messages and stuff, so I want to preach some dirt to you today. I want to preach dirt. We'll start out here. Go to Psalms 139 for a minute. In Psalms 139, verse 14, it talks about how we're fearfully and wonderfully made. Just a bunch of dirt. Just a speck of dirt. It's all hard. He's putting this down again. No, I'm not. I'm a speck of dirt just like you. I will praise thee, Psalms 139, 14, for I am fearfully and wonderfully made. Now, I'm a speck of dirt, fearfully and wonderfully made. Marvelous are thy works, and that my soul knoweth right well. Remember a couple weeks ago I read this. I'm going to read it again today, not for redundancy, but lets us know what we're worth. Dave put this together in his commentary. He said we're worth 98 cents, but you count in inflation, we're probably worth about $2 now. The body is wonderfully made, Psalms 139, 14 says. It consists of various chemicals, iron, sugar, salt, carbon, iodine, phosphorus, lime, calcium, and others. And don't forget we're two-thirds water, just like the earth is two-thirds water. So this shows us what we're made out of, and we come from a speck of dirt. The body has 263 bones, 600 muscles, 970 miles of blood vessels, 400 cups on the tongue to taste, 20 million hairs in the ear to tune in to all sounds, and also those hairs help keep our balance. 40 pounds of jaw pressure so we can eat, 10 million nerves and branches, 3,500 sweat tubes to each square inch of skin, or 40 miles long. I know that for a fact, the way I sweat. I can sweat. I'm sweating right now, not even doing it. 20 million mouths that suck in food as it goes through the intestinal tract and digest. 600 million air cells to the lungs to inhale 2,400 gallons of air daily, and a telephone system to relate to the brain instantly any known sound, taste, sight, touch, smell, or even danger. If you stick your finger with a pin or step on a nail, you instantly feel it, don't you? The heart pumps 4,200 times an hour and pumps over 12 tons of blood daily. You know, if you take your lungs and took the way it spread it out in unraveled it all, it would fill up an entire football field. You know that? And God took those lungs and put them in his body. Yeah. Now, where would I get that? I want you to go to Genesis 3. I want to show you the curse. I know you're familiar with it, but I want you to go to Genesis 3 to start. Then we're going to go to Mark 4, the parable of the soils. And don't say, oh, I knew that. Terrible. No, you don't know that parable like I'm going to instruct today. Dirt. I'm going to preach dirt to you. Look here in Genesis 3. Now, the serpent was more cunning than any beast in the field in which the Lord God had made. And he had said to the woman, has God indeed said, you shall not eat? See, now, if you look at the parable of the sower, you can see Satan in it. When we get to the parable of the sower, think back at this passage. You shall not eat of every tree in the garden. God never said that. And a woman said to the serpent, you may eat of the fruit of the trees of the garden. She was right. But of the tree which is in the middle of the garden, God said, you shall not eat. He didn't say you couldn't touch it. He said, don't eat it. So she's already added to and subtracted from the word. That's a dangerous thing to do. You shall not eat it or touch it, lest you die. And the serpent said to the woman, you shall not surely die. Your God knows that in your, for God knows in the day that you eat of it, your eyes will be open and will be like God, knowing good and evil. So the woman saw that the tree was good for food, and it was pleasant to the eyes, lust to the eyes, lust to the flesh, and the pride of life. And the tree desirable to make one wise, we'd be better off being stupid, let me tell you that. She took of its fruit, ate, she also gave it to her husband. That means he was standing right next to her. He said, don't do it, you know better than that, we're not going to do it. But ah, he let her do it. So guys, don't blame your wives. We had a part of this too. She also gave her husband with her, he ate. The eyes of both of them were open, and they knew that they were naked. They sewed fig leaves together and made themselves coverings. Notice they weren't afraid to stand in the presence of God prior to this act. After this, God comes and they flee. And they heard the sound of the one walking in the garden in the cool of the day. I mean, early in the morning or in the evening. Probably early in the morning. And Adam and his wife hid themselves in the presence of the Lord. On the tree of the garden. Let me tell you something. You know why people don't want to speak in tongues, why they don't want to be around Pentecostals? Because they're hiding themselves from the presence of the Lord because there's sin in their life. The Holy Ghost will expose the sin in our lives. It's not pleasant. It doesn't feel good, but it needs to be done so we can walk with Him. Then the Lord God called to Adam and said to him, where are you? He said, I heard your voice in the garden. I was afraid. See, that's the spirit of anxiety and fear. Fallen nature. Prior to that, they didn't have anxiety and they weren't afraid. I heard the voice of the garden. I was afraid because I was naked and I hid myself. Can you name me one good thing that God has eaten out of forbidden fruit? I can't name one good thing. And he said, who told you you were naked? Have you eaten of the tree which I command you to, that you should not eat? You know, if they would have just come clean with God, who knows what would happen? They might have got forgiven. They might have been cast out of the garden. No, they wanted to lie about it. You know, you can't lie to God. God knows it. Might as well just confess it. Some people think they're so slick that they're going to lie to God. You can't lie to God. They say, how can you be so transparent? Well, God knows what I did, so I was just come clean and admit to it. I did it. Forgive me. Let's move on. But under what? It's only the pride on the earth that will do that. And then man said, the woman is hurt. You know, what would it be? God, you know, everything was going good. It was just you and me, bud. You know, we're buds. Everything's cool. I got to name all the animals, you know, all the plant life and the, you know, everything in the heaven and earth and the sea. Got to name it all. Everything was cool. It was just you and me. But you gave me her. She's been a pain in my side ever since. What is that? In the actual words, he said, the woman whom you gave me. In other words, God, it's your fault. Don't blame God for your sin. You did it. It felt good at the time. You ever notice how good it feels while you're sinning, how bad you feel after sin? Let me say that again. You ever notice how good it feels for your flesh when you're sinning, but how bad you feel after you sin? Can I hear an amen? Am I preaching anybody today? I know the devil. I mean, I know what he does. He's done to me enough. They got to be smart and not fall for it again. Sometimes I fall for it. You gave me, the woman you gave me to be with me, she gave me the tree and I ate. Well, she might have gave it to you, but you didn't have to eat, bud. And the Lord said to the woman, what is this you have done? The woman said, hey, my fault, this little snake. Now, come on. This woman, she's a full-grown woman, you know, mature woman, you know, all the womanhood there. And this little bitty snake, I don't picture it being a cobra or a boa constrictor, or one of these snakes that are this big around 100 foot long. I picture it being this little bitty thing. Somewhere there. Even if it was a boa constrictor, come on now. This snake, the serpent deceived me and I ate. So the Lord God said to the serpent, because you've done this, you are cursed more than the cattle, more than every beast of the field, on your belly shall go, and you shall eat the dust all days of your life. Since you messed with man and came from dust, you will eat dust. And I will put a division between you and that woman, enmity between you and her, between her offspring and you, your offspring, demons. He shall bruise, the man's going to bruise your head, and you're going to bite his heel. Jesus got nailed to the cross, suffered and died, and he rose again, breaking the head of Satan. The woman said to the woman, he said, I will greatly multiply your sorrow and conception. The pain you shall bring forth children, your desire shall be to your, for your husband. He shall rule over you. In other words, you're going to be in charge, and you're going to be under him. And then Adam said, because you have heeded the voice of your wife, have eaten the tree which I command you, saying, you shall not eat of it. Cursed is the ground for your sake. You're going to work by sweat. You're going to toil. In toil and sweat, you shall eat of it all the days of your life. And thorns and thistles it shall bring forth for you, and you shall eat of the herb of the field, and the sweat of your face you shall eat of the bread, till you return to the ground, for out of it you were taken, for dust you are, and dust you shall return. And Adam called his wife Eve, because she was the mother of all living things. Also Adam and his wife, the Lord God, made tunics of skin and clothed them. He offered a blood sacrifice, showed him how to have a blood sacrifice, and showed him that the blood would cover the sins. And was a symbol of the blood of the sacrifice covering them and their sin in the presence of an angry God. Then the Lord said, behold, the man has become like one of us, knowing good and evil. Now lest he put out his hand and take of the tree of life and eat and live forever. Therefore, the Lord God sent him out of the Garden of Eden to till the ground from which he was taken. He drove them out and placed the cherubim at the east of the Garden of Eden, a flaming sword that turned every way to guard the way of the tree of life. That's the bad news. The good news is Christ said he would come and win us back. Now I want you to go into Mark the 4th chapter. Poor soils. Jesus was teaching on this. Mark the 4th chapter. And he began to teach by the sea. A great multitude gathered to him. So he got into the boat. He sat on the sea, and the whole multitude was on the land facing the sea. In other words, there were so many people on land, he had to go out to the boat and use the water to project his voice so they could hear it. Then he taught them many things by parables, and he said to them in his teaching, listen, behold, a sower went out to sow. And it happened as he sowed that some seed fell by the wayside, and the birds of the air came to devour it. Some fell on stony ground where it did not have much earth. And immediately it sprang up because it had no depth of earth. But when the sun was up, it was scorched, and because it had no root, withered away. And some seed fell among the thorns, and the thorns grew up, choked it, yielded no crop. But others' seed fell on good ground, yielded a crop, sprang up, increased, produced 30, 60, and 100-fold. He said to them, he who hath ears, let him hear. And the Holy Spirit said to this church this morning, he that hath ears, let him hear what the Spirit says to this church today. But when he was alone, when Jesus was alone, those around him, the disciples, the 12, asked him about the parable. And he said to them, to you it has been given to know the mystery of the kingdom of God, but to those who are outside, all things come in parables, so that seeing they may not perceive, and hearing they may not hear, and not understand, lest they should turn and their sin be forgiven. And Jesus said to them, do you not understand this parable? How then will you understand all the parables? Now we're going to talk about this in the explanation. But before we do, I want you to look at a couple of scriptures. Hold your place here because we're coming back to Mark. There's something that has to happen before the farmer can scatter the seed. If you would turn to Jeremiah, the 4th chapter, the 3rd verse, Jeremiah says it this way. It's called fallow ground. And in Jeremiah 4:3, he brings this up because this was an agrarian society, a society that most were farmers or shepherds, and they would understand this. And Jesus did the same thing. In Jeremiah 4:3, it says, for thus saith the Lord to the men of Judah and Jerusalem, to praise, Judah means praise, and Jerusalem, a picture of the modern church. This is specifically to Israel, but let's look at it this way. Judah, we're supposed to be people of praise, and to our church. Break up the fallow ground. Do not sow among thorns. Remember those thorns in the parable? Circumcise yourself to the Lord and take away the foreskins of your heart, you people of praise, inhabitants of the church. Lest my fury come forth like fire and burn so that no one can quench it because of the evil of your doings. Turn to Hosea 6. Hosea chapter 6, Hosea chapter 10. We'll get to that 6 later. Hosea chapter 10, verse 12. What does Hosea say? Sow for yourself Jesus Christ, righteousness. Reap his mercy. Break up the fallow ground of your heart. For it is time to seek the Lord Jesus Christ till he comes and rains his righteousness on you. You have plowed wickedness. You reap iniquity. You have eaten the fruit of lies because you trust in your own way in the multitude of your mighty men. Sow yourself Jesus Christ. Reap his mercy. Break up the fallow ground of your heart so that the early and latter rain will come, the rain of the Holy Ghost. Now something has to happen, brothers and sisters, before the presence of God will come to us. And I've noticed for too many Sundays now, we come in here, we have so much on our mind. Where is everybody at? Yes, on your mind. Or maybe you got the fight with your spouse or your children before you got here. Or maybe the worries of this week or last week. Who knows? And we're all guilty of this. If you want a service, every service like we had today, and I intended to call you to the altar and do this if it hadn't happened prior to me getting up here to ministry. Because before the farmer can sow the seed, something has to happen to the dirt. Now, we've all established we're nothing but a bag of dirt. Can I hear an amen? Yeah. What are we? Nothing but a bag of dirt, right? But God placed high value on this bag of dirt, let me tell you. The bag of dirt was so valuable to him, it was worth more than $2. It was worth his blood shed on the cross. That's how valuable you are to him. Now, in the eyes of man, the eyes of the flesh were only a couple bucks. And the sun were just the flyover states out here. The only thing important is the East Coast, the West Coast, everything in between. Just pay your taxes, shut up. I hear an amen. Well, let me tell you something. God don't treat us as flyover state. God has treated us wonderfully with his presence here. choose to. Why? Because he's told us time and time again, it's in his presence where things happen. And he wants us, when we come here, to put aside all the things. Leave it out there. Leave it out there. Don't bring it in here. And be concentrating on getting into his presence. And we have to practice this each day. We've got to break up the soil. We've got to break up the fallow ground. Now, let me give you a definition of fallow. What fallow ground is what the government calls land, the farmer's soil, and soil bank. I don't know if they do this anymore, but they used to pay the farmer to keep their ground fallow. And Israel did it every 7 years. And the purpose of laying the ground fallow is that you don't want to suck all the nutrients out of the ground. If you keep planting and planting and planting in that same ground, it will be, all the nutrients will be gone from that ground, and when you plant the crop, nothing will happen. What's fallow mean? It's a light yellowish brown color, fallow. But what does it mean? It's an old English word. It means cultivate the land that is allowed to lay idle during the growing season. In other words, what happens is fallow ground gets plowed, disked, and tilled, and the farmer breaks up the ground. He plows it under, turns the ground, he disks it and tills it, it's ready to plant, but doesn't plant it. Now, why in the world would a farmer break up the fallow ground? He breaks it up so there's oxygen and nutrients, and when the rain comes, all the things coming down in the rain that God sends can penetrate deep into that ground that's been plowed over. If the crust of the ground from the previous part of the season hadn't been broken up and turned and plowed and disked and made ready, when the rain comes, early and latter rain, it'll just run off. Have you seen rains out here where it rains hard, we haven't had rain for a long time, and the ground gets that crust on it, and Claremont County is good for it because of that yellow clay. Man, I tell you what, when it gets soft, you get a big 4x4 tractor sunk up past the axles, all the way up to the belly. And when it's dry, you can't take a jackhammer to get through it because it's like concrete. But this ground is the best ground to plant in because it'll grow everything, including weeds. Can I hear an amen? If you can't grow anything out here, you can grow weeds. Can I hear an amen? But if you want to grow something that will sustain your life, you got to break up that fallow ground. You got to break the crust off the top. You got to do a little work to turn that ground over and get it ready and let it lay fallow for the nutrients to sink in. Now here's the point. What have you done Sunday after Sunday? Do you come into a fallow ground, or did you break the ground up to receive the seed that has been sown? Only you can answer that question. If you come in here with all these problems on your mind, you're not going to get what God wants you to have. So what we have to do, we have to prepare the soil for the master. We got to prepare this ground. We got to be prepared. We got to do some plowing, some disking, some tilling, some fertilize. We have to get this ground of flesh ready to receive the word of God. Look here now. He gives the explanation. The sower, the farmer, sows the word of God. Now, there's more than one farmer in this church. I'm a farmer. I sow the seed Sunday after Sunday. But you're going to be farmers also. Monday through Sunday. Sunday through the next Sunday. Wherever you go, you're supposed to have so much of Jesus in you that you can sow the word of God, sow the seed of God, sow the word which is the seed of God, sow the seed which is the word of God. But if you don't partake of the word of God daily, and if you don't break up the fallow ground in your heart so you can receive what the Lord's trying to sow in you, you'll have nothing to give to those out there that are in desperate need of what you and I have. These are the ones by the wayside where the word is sown, and when they hear, Satan comes immediately and takes away the word which was sown in their hearts.
Why did he talk about Adam and Eve?
Let me show you. God told him, eat any tree you want. That one in the middle, you stay away from, don't eat it. And that day you'll surely die. So the devil comes, and he says, the bird comes, the birds come. Satan, the birds, not Alfred Hitchcock's the birds, Satan, the birds show up. And he says, God never sent that to you. That really got to God. How many times do you try to witness to someone and someone says, that's not what the Bible says? And how do you know you have the right Bible? You have the right translation? There's so many books that are left out after all. I see it on History Channel, all these left out gospels and so forth. That's the bird and the bird brain speaking. Can I hear an amen? That's the birds and the devil speaking that kind of nonsense. See, the bird of Satan, the demonic forces of Satan came to Adam and Eve, and they knew full well, precisely, 100% positive, exactly what God said, and they didn't even have a Bible back then, but they had the living, walking, talking word of God. His name was Jesus, who visited them every morning and instructed them in the ways of God. But they chose to believe the lie instead of the love of the truth. So the birds show up and they take out what's immediately been trying to be sown in her heart. Notice in each one of these soils, the wayside soil, the stony soil, and the thorny soil, notice that the word hit their heart. They heard it. They got it. But there's a responsibility of you and me, dirtbags, the soil, when we hear the word. We have a responsibility to that word to either receive it and apply it and use it or reject it. Some of us knowingly reject it, others unknowingly reject it. The sower, the farmer sows the word, and then the birds come. Now let's look at the next soil. These likewise are the ones sown on stony ground, who when they hear the word, immediately receive it with, I'm so glad. That was a great message. That was a beautiful message. That was just such a, I can't wait to use this message. And as they're walking out the door, you say, what did I preach on? Sometimes I'm just guilty of something. Like, what were your points of the message, Father? What did I preach on? I preached it! Oh, yeah. You think I'm joking? I'm just being blatantly honest. See, the devil does his job. He shows up here every Sunday, whether you're here or not, and he's here to pluck the word out. Some right away, some a little later. They receive it with gladness. It's always a great message. But they have no root where? In themselves. If you're trying to be rooted in yourself, you're being rooted in the wrong thing, baby. The root has to be in God and in Jesus Christ and in his word sown deep into our hearts. See, they have no root in themselves. They receive it with gladness. But they have no root in themselves. They have no depth. They're surface Christians, superficial. And they never get taught on how to battle the devil. That's why when the battle's come, the backside. I wasn't told that was going to happen. Well, it does. Hello. They have no root in themselves and endure for only a time. Afterward, when tribulation or persecution arises, what's it arise for? Because Jesus Christ is living in your heart. If Jesus wasn't living in your heart, there would be no persecution or problems arising because the devil done got you. Can I hear an amen? But if the devil ain't got you and God's got you, the devil's going to fight to get you back. That's where the battle's at. And you have the choice whether you want to go back or whether you want to go forward. And like Marvin Lewis says, moving forward. I don't know about you, but I had enough of the devil and his world. I lived good for the devil when I lived for the devil. I didn't know I was living for the devil. I was living for myself. But when God got a hold of me and the Son of Jesus got a hold of me, I knew there was no turning back. The Bible says if you do, you'll be 7 times worse. I was bad enough before. I don't want to be 7 times worse than that. See, persecution and tribulation will come because of Jesus Christ living in you. And immediately they backslide, they stumble, they fall. Now let's go to the third soil. So that's a wayside, that's a stony. Let's talk about the thorny ones. We don't want to get stuck here. Could get stuck on the thorns. Now these are the ones sown among the thorns. And they're the ones who hear the word. Vacillate between thorny soil and good soil. Thorny, good, good, thorny, good. This is the battle. Life has its problems, cares in this world, and then the deceitfulness of riches. If I just had a little more money, if I just had a few more hours, if I just had a house, if I just had a car, if I just had a good looking wife, if I just had these kids, if I just had this, if I just had that, I'd be happy. No, you wouldn't. It wouldn't last. What you want is joy that lasts forever. You can have everything that money can buy and everything, including the money, and you can be just as miserable as sin because you don't have the joy of the Lord. What happens is, happiness is fleeting. It lasts for a moment. You get something, a possession, whatever, you're happy for a while. But when the novelty wears off and the payments later on, all you got is the same old move, doom, gloom, misery, despair. You need the joy that lasts forever. The joy of the Lord. Only the Lord can bring this joy in our life. Like that old country western song, looking for love in all the wrong places. We do that. The cares of this world, the deceitfulness of riches, the lust of other things, enters in and we become unfruitful. It's not that we're not saved. It's that we're not doing anything for the kingdom. We get caught up in making a living, get caught up taking care of the family, get caught up doing the things of life, get caught up. The first thing you know, that was last Sunday, we're in church, and this is already next Sunday, we haven't even opened the Bible all week. Haven't thought of God all week. Haven't prayed all week. We just got so busy. Well, you understand, I get up, the kids are up before me, and I got a diaper this one, to feed this one, I got to do this, and I got to do that, and I get no peace, and I get to send a couple off to school, but then, you know, and then they come home from school, and it's on and on and on, I don't even get a nap in. That'll change. When it does, you wish it hadn't. You'll grow up, you'll have an empty nest, and you'll look back and say, where did my life go? I did all this, and this is where I wanted to get. I'd rather have it the other way. The cares of this world, the deceitfulness, rich, lust, other things, and it chokes out our relationship with God if we're not careful. This is what we got to guard against. But the ones who sow on good ground, who hear the word and accept it, bear fruit, some 30, 60, 100 fold, and the kind of fruit that needs produced in our life, turn with me, if you would, please, to Galatians. I used to think of this as producing fruit for the kingdom and winning souls, which it does mean that. It does mean producing fruit in the kingdom winning souls, without a doubt. But there's other fruit that needs to be produced. And brothers and sisters, if we're not careful, what happens is in fighting in this Christian life and in trying to be good Christians and in trying to see our church grow and things like this, we lose sight of our love for Jesus. We lose sight of the goodness that He wants to bring into our life. I see that in Galatians 5:16, walk in the Spirit, you will not fulfill the lust of the flesh. For the flesh lusts against the Spirit against the flesh. And these are contrary to each other, so that you do not do the things which you wish. But if you're led by the Spirit, you're not under the law. It talks about the works of the flesh there. Let's skip down to the 22nd verse. But the fruit, some 30, some 60, some 100 fold that should be produced, is the love, the joy, and peace, and patience, that's what long-suffering is, and kindness, and goodness, and faithfulness, gentleness, self-control, against such there is no law. And those who are Christ have crucified the flesh with its passions and desires. If we live by the Spirit, if we live in the Spirit, let us also walk in the Spirit. Let us become not become conceited, provoking one another, envying one another. We can be so much into living our life and in the battle that we forget to let the fruit of the Spirit grow in our life. We lose that joy. We lose that love. And this morning we had a little love fest going on here. We were in the presence of Jesus Christ. And what happens in that presence, things start to change in our life. Shackles of darkness start to break. We no longer have the anxieties and fears that we had when we're praising in the Spirit. The stuff just lifts off of us and goes. This is a little taste of what heaven's going to be like. When we get to heaven, there'll be no more sickness, no more death, no more sorrow, no more pain, no more bills to pay, no more job to go to. No We'll have a job up there. He's going to give us some duties, but it will be such a delight to do those duties compared to what we have to do now, the drudgery of the week.